Hello, this is Bible Academy for Children. I'm Pastor Teacher Curtis Omo, and today we're going to look at our series, A Survey of the Old Testament, looking at the book of Proverbs. Now, before we get started, as always, let's make sure that we have confessed our known sins and that we are allowing the Spirit of God, who indwells us, to control us. Let's pray. Well, Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this privilege, the opportunity, the good health, and everything you provided for us to study your word today. We ask that our hearts and minds be open and ready to receive your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, again, as the last one, these are the same notes that the adults got when I go over it a second time, or I read through it and say, what would be better for children? I thought, well, I think they can handle this with a little bit of extra explaining. So that's what we're going to do. The purpose of Proverbs. Now, if you've studied the book of Proverbs, the CS, the children's series, some of this you're going to be familiar with. That's a good thing. But if you haven't, that's okay too. We'll do the survey, then you can go back and study that when you're ready. Let's talk about the purpose. The purpose of Proverbs, to collect the wisdom of Israel to teach God's people on how to live the godly life. 2, to shape character and promote righteousness in line with the Mosaic law. 3, as stated in the purpose, to develop wisdom that begins with the knowledge of the fear of God. Of the Lord. The purpose is stated here in point 3 is in the prologue of the Proverbs, the first several verses. So we're learning Proverbs for the purpose to develop wisdom and a godly life. For the Old Testament saint, that was also in accordance with the Mosaic law. Major themes: the fear of the Lord, the Retribution Principle 3, we'll go deeper on that, human speech and human sexuality. I wouldn't worry about that part. Parents, we'll take that easy with the kids. God's presence. Since God is the source and provider of wisdom, we see God's presence in the personification of wisdom. Personification means like wisdom is a person. Wisdom is speaking. Okay, so that's like experiencing the presence of God. God is talking to you, you see, in His Word. In fact, that's something you can experience all the time. His presence is also seen in the theological principle of the fear of the Lord, rooted in Israel's covenant relationships with Yahweh. Remember, the covenant relationship was the fact that they lived under the Mosaic law, the law given by Moses. We weren't given Moses' law. We're not Israel. We're given the new covenant by Christ. We have some things we learned from the Mosaic law. Of course, many things, in fact, especially in the history of Israel. And, well, things like the Proverbs and the Psalms, those are all given under the law. But many of them are helpful today. We sort those out individually. Let's look at the outline, the title and the purpose, 1-7. 2, a father on the way of wisdom, where he gives discourses, that is, speeches on wisdom, on marriage and adultery, wisdom personified. 3, Proverbs of Solomon. 4, 30 sayings of the wise. 5, further sayings of the wise. 6, well, more Proverbs of Solomon. And then we have some additions at the end. Number 7, the sayings of Algor, son of Jacob, the sayings of Lemuel, and an anonymous, we don't know who wrote it, acrostic, remember that's in the Hebrew alphabetical order, poem of the ideal wife. This shows us that Proverbs are skillfully arranged and not just a collection of random sayings. So there's a purpose to their order. Let's talk about a definition of a proverb. Though studied in detail in the introductory lessons to the Proverbs series, we will use a brief definition of a proverb in this study. Here it is. A proverb was basically a wise saying derived from experience and observation. It is generally true, but not a promise, because there are many exceptions. For our purposes, it basically gives instructions on how to make the best decisions in this world in relation to the law, that is, the Old Testament law, what we call the Old Covenant. Proverbs teaches how to live a godly life in a world filled with ungodliness. Proverbs teaches right behavior, including morality, in a variety of situations. It is practical and rooted in the experience of life common to all. As such, it has a lasting endurance. It is skillful living. Let's talk about its writing. The four leadership classes of Israel were the king, prophet, and the priest. The sage, or the wise man, completes the list. There's your scripture references. The book of Proverbs gives us the legacy of those wise men. A legacy basically means something that is left behind, that is worth leaving behind, something you can look at, something you can use, something you can remember them by. The sage was usually associated with the royal court. He advised the king and taught the people, Ecclesiastes 12:9, especially the next generation of leaders. Wise men were also found among other nations. So what I'm saying here is that other peoples, other cultures, other countries had their own wise men as well. The book of Proverbs begins with a prologue followed by 8 collections of wise sayings. 5 have introductions and superscriptions. Solomon is often called the wisest man who ever lived and was so in the ancient East and Egypt, 1 Kings 4:29 through 34. The Old Testament attests, or that means testifies or witnesses, to his knowledge in areas of science, literature, and knowledge in general. I mean, his head was like an encyclopedia. He was credited with uttering over 3,000 proverbs, and hundreds are in the book of Proverbs. He also had some 1,005 songs. A couple of those songs, Psalm 72:127. Solomon, remember that's David's son, made it popular, wisdom, tradition in Israel, and for a time lived it out in his life. And he was a model. For future generations. Even his failures, as reflected in the wisdom of Ecclesiastes, are points of wisdom. He starts in the book of Ecclesiastes, which we'll get to. He talks about what he learned in his life. And a lot of it was from trying different things. He found out there's no real purpose in doing that, pursuing this or pursuing that in life. It's really about a relationship with God. So he even learned from his failures. We have these men mentioned, Agar. Nothing is known of Agar or Lemuel of Massa. It is suspected they are members of the northern tribe of Massa, that is Lemuel, one of the sons of Ishmael. You can look that up and see his name. Both are discussed briefly in the Proverbs series. This attests, remember that means testifies, to the value of wisdom to the ancient world and peoples. Remember, Job was from Uz of Edom. So, again, I'm just saying, wisdom was common in the ancient world. Israel had their own. The reference to Hezekiah's scribes, which you see in the Proverbs, Hezekiah was one of the kings of Judah, one of the last kings of Judah, in editing at least one of the wisdom collections. So what I'm saying is some of the scribes that worked in the royal court of Hezekiah helped collect the Proverbs for the people of Israel. So that tells us that the book could not have been completed until his time. All right. His reign ended 8th century B.C. Solomon material is considered to be the oldest, and his dates back to the 10th century B.C. The sayings at the end of the book may have been as late as the exile. So what we end up having is these different people mentioned within the book, like Solomon or Hezekiah, knowing that this was done over a period of time, but it probably wouldn't have been collected until they were back from the exile. This means the Proverbs date from the 10th to the 6th century B.C., the latter time being the likely time of final composition. So it covered some 500 years of collection. It's a long time to write a book, isn't it? Well, it was really a collection of sayings. Talk about the background of Proverbs. Here's where it's a little different. The history of the Israelites hardly play a role in the background of the Proverbs. This further shows the practical value and the enduring nature of the Proverbs. It points to one of its purposes, which is to live right in this world, no matter when your time of life is on this earth. In other words, what this is saying is the Proverbs aren't really tied into the history of Israel like so many teachings, like the prophets and the kings and so on. But they're principles that are for your life whenever you live, whether it be in the Old Testament times or New Testament times, ancient times or modern times. The principles are true as understood. Next paragraph. Instructional wisdom in the ancient world came from the family or clan. Notice the family taught them wisdom. The royal court, or the scribal schools. If you were upper class, you'd probably send your kids to the scribal schools, where they would learn to be leaders. Next sentence. The collection of the wise sayings were usually the duty of those in the royal courts in Israel and true elsewhere in the ancient East. In other words, it's in the royal courts where wisdom got taught. It wasn't only in Israel, however. It was in other countries of the Near East. The royal courts were the primary places for the training of future leaders for the government. So we would expect that to be the primary place of collection. So we're just saying is probably the royal courts where we have the wise men who collected these things. The historical context for wisdom came from the time of the United Monarchy, that's under King Solomon, to that in Judah under Hezekiah. Wise men in the court would train diplomats, officials, administrators, future leaders, and others to act wisely toward foreigners. This would produce godly leadership, that is, the training in the courts, confronting the godless of the world with all their polytheistic beliefs. Remember, polytheism, Israel was the only nation who believed in one God. Other nations believed in many gods, remember? So when they took Israel's wisdom to these other nations, to these other people, or expressed it when they came there, they could witness to them. Next sentence, with the fear of God linked to Hebrew wisdom, this was also a way to spread the knowledge of the one true God to the world. So that helped them be a testimony. It became a tool, you might say, to use to tell others about God. At the top, wisdom, Hebrew wisdom, also helped the kings and administrators of Israel stay in line with the law and right conduct. So it would help them live according to the Mosaic law and live right. It provided not only wise ways in which to protect people's lives and rights, but also the poor and the needy. The law taught to take care of the poor and the needy. So did the Proverbs. It taught how to deal with other nations and have a sound economy. It kept society straight as long as the people followed it. It showed the advantages of a life of marriage to one person and avoid all others. It showed children how to live right from an early age. It taught young people to control the various urges of youth. It instilled, that means it taught it real well to you, to respect the king, government, and parental authority. As the king ruled wisely with justice and righteousness before God, the nation prospered. And when it did not, it suffered. Listen to these two Proverbs. 20:28. Love and faithfulness keep a king safe. Through love his throne is made secure. 24:21. Fear the Lord and the king, my son, and do not join with rebellious officials. Notice, fear the Lord and the king. Honor the king. Learn to honor the king. Purpose and message. Now remember, you can take a break when you want. Think about this, go over it, discuss it. The message of Proverbs is based on the belief that wisdom can be gained and passed on from one generation to the next. 4:1-9. It is more precious than any jewels, gold, or silver. It is necessary that young people receive, believe, and apply it in their lives. They hear it from their elders, parents, and sages. Remember, sage is just another word for a wise person. Today, they learn it from their parents and Bible teachers and reading it themselves. You want to learn wisdom? Study it in the Word. Have a good study Bible or your parents with you. Study the videos. That'll help. Old Testament wisdom is to be desired and obeyed. It teaches to forsake the path of darkness, evil, and death, 2:11-15, and walk in the path of integrity, righteousness, justice, and life, 2:1-10. Now, if you're a young person, you've been studying the Proverbs series, you know a lot of this already. So this is kind of review, but you have some new stuff here. Tells you where we're going. Now listen to this. The practical benefits, things that you can really use of wisdom, are numerous if one is disciplined enough to walk in its ways. If you hear that piano in the background, that's the cat. I don't know why he likes to play the piano in the morning while I'm doing a Bible study. Not very good, is he? For the Old Testament saint to walk in wisdom meant to understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God and developing one's covenant relationship with Him. Don't miss that. I read it kind of fast. Let me read it again. For the Old Testament saint to walk in wisdom meant to understand the fear of the Lord and finding the knowledge of God and developing one's covenant relationship with Him. Now, we'll talk more about the fear of the Lord later. But don't forget, the covenant and the fear of the Lord were both tied into learning wisdom. The fear of the Lord becomes a worshiping, reverent submission to the God of the covenant. This leads to a right relationship with God and man, and lining one's life up with the covenant. This produces right behavior and a righteous life. It gives one understanding and discernment, the ability to make good choices and keep one's life from the many traps of life. If you haven't started studying Proverbs with your parents, well, I'd say to the parents first, you're both missing out. It keeps one from evil and delivers him from ruin. The way of wisdom leads to health, abundance, good welfare, peace, long life, prosperity, safety, and righteousness. And there's you some scriptures. Wisdom would have been a vital part of the youth's upbringing. It would have been like an important textbook in their education. It was used to train the youth in how to be godly. Today, it should be used to train young people to grow up to be good Christian gentlemen and ladies. And I read this, I'm reminded of when I was in high school. We actually had the option as one of our classes to go across the street off campus and study from a Bible teacher. And we did. Even had that when I was in the first grade. We could go study the Bible during our school time, but we'd have to go off campus. Seems kind of silly, doesn't it? You have to go across the street because you're not allowed to do it on state property, because there's a misunderstanding of separation of church and state. That's from a misunderstanding of the Constitution. Structure and organization. Three major divisions in the Proverbs are easily identified. The discourse material, that's a speech material, the collection of Proverbs, and the Masaite appendices, that's the stuff that's added at the end of the book. Only a basic relationship between the various collections are given here. I'm just giving you a general idea how they go together. That's all we get. The wisdom prologue of 1 through 7 serves as an introduction to the entire body of literature. Prologue serves its purpose. It gives you an idea of what's coming. It sets the general historical context for the instruction in wisdom, outlines the purposes and dogmas, that means the hard truths of the teaching, contained in the collections of wise sayings, and provides certain interpretive principles, and introduces the major theme of biblical wisdom literature. And again, this is one of those things I don't expect you to remember, but it gives you an idea of what we're having here when we come to the book of Proverbs. We're going to get some instruction. We're not worried about the history so much, but the history we need to know is that it's a father teaching a son, it's wisdom from Solomon, and we have that little bit of a context where a father's teaching his son about, well, marriage, for instance, or human sexuality, that God gives boundaries on these things. These are general principles that we learn and take them into the book of Proverbs when we study them. We understand who's teaching what. God taught the parent taught the child. All right? The child grows up and teaches it to his children. You see? From generation to generation. Next paragraph. The series of discourses, that's speeches, in chapters 1-8 through 19 are generally understood to post-date the proverbial collections of 10-1 through 10-29-27. Okay? So that's basically telling you what time they came in relation to the other section. The speeches and instructions, warnings, and admonitions in this section elaborate, that means they talk about more, on the theme of wisdom presented in the prologue. That's at the beginning. So basically what we're saying is they just expand on what we learn in the prologue. True wisdom comes from God, but one must learn to fear the Lord. Now listen to this. The fear of the Lord is rooted in and conditioned by thy directives, the instructions, of Yahweh's covenant with Israel, 6:16 through 19. These discourses illustrate the fear of the Lord by contrasting the behavior of the wise and righteous with the foolish and wicked. Now let me just talk to you about the fear of the Lord. You know, let me use an illustration. Would you listen to someone you didn't respect? Would you take their advice? No. Because you don't think they're worth listening to. When it comes to the fear of the Lord, we have to have great respect for the Lord and revere Him, reverence Him, think highly of Him. If we don't do that, we're not going to take His word seriously. So what we got to understand is when it comes to the fear of the Lord, if we're going to start learning, it begins with the fear of the Lord. Next paragraph. Overt references to Israel's religion are less prominent in the proverbial collections, 10:1 through 29 through 27. Than in the discourses. This section reinforces the teaching of the discourses by specifying how the fear of the Lord pragmatically, that means how it practically is applied, how you use it in everyday life, it shapes the behavior of the righteous and the wise. So all we're saying is here is that it's not so much about Israel's religion. It's just, here's what you can do in life to your advantage. Learn these things to your advantage. The proverbial instruction makes up a practical exposition of the moral law of the Torah designed to help seekers to apply wisdom principles to everyday life. So what we're saying here, let's understand the fear of the Lord. We got that, right? You fear the Lord. You seek Him. You want to know Him? All right. You have a good start if you fear Him. You want to know Him? You do so by learning to live by the old covenant, the Mosaic Law. Now, I'm talking about people who lived in the Old Testament times now. You understand? Because this is who this was written to. Don't ever forget that. This is originally written to the Old Testament saints during the time of the Mosaic Law. And everything in the Old Testament has to be filtered through the New Testament today. Because we know more about things, and there's different applications. We have the Holy Spirit. Christ has come and resurrected, and He's ascended, and He's in heaven right now ruling. We come under a different set of rules. However, many of the things taught in the Old Testament can be used for today. That's why I teach the Proverbs. Because most all of them, if properly understood in the context in which it was originally written, and this is what I'm trying to teach you right now, it had to work within the framework of the Mosaic Law, which meant that they had to be obedient. The obedient life plus wisdom was the best way to live. The more wisdom you knew, the better off you would be. And to follow the Proverbs principles, the more prosperous, successful, and so on. As you can see, there's a lot to learn here. I mean, the Proverbs seem simple sometimes, but actually they're very deep in many ways. Next paragraph, the additions at the end of the book review the themes previously discussed in the proverbial sections. The acrostic poem, remember that's one that uses the Hebrew alphabet, the beginning of each line. The acrostic poem of the virtuous woman serves as a case study of highlighting the preferred outcomes of the way of wisdom. In other words, the story, the description of the virtuous woman tells you an example of what it's like to live with wisdom, what a married woman would do, the kind of person she would be. Next paragraph, these additions also affirm the divine authority inherent, that means within, the Hebrew wisdom tradition. In other words, Hebrew wisdom came from God, and they recognized it. Finally, the Masaite additions to the book recapitulate, that's a way of saying they kind of restate and go over, the importance of the social aspects of the way of wisdom promoted in the proverbial sections, like maintaining the rights of the poor and the needy. Now, all I'm saying here is that these additions at the end of the book of Proverbs state again some of the things they learned in the Proverbs, and including taking care of the poor and the needy. Major themes. Fear of the Lord. Ancient nations like Babylon and Egypt worshipped many gods, while Israel was unique, that means special, in worshipping only the Lord God. The book of Proverbs teaches that the fear of God is where knowledge of God begins. When one begins to seek the Lord and learn of Him, he will learn to understand the fear of the Lord. In the Old Testament, this was associated with the Mosaic Covenant. God alone possesses wisdom. He only gives it to those who know Him. In the Old Testament, this was related to the covenant. Covenant loyalty was expressed in obedience to the covenant. This demonstrated a love for God. Today, it is those who seek to know God through Jesus Christ, who follow Christ at all cost. These are those who discover the depth and wisdom of God in His Word and demonstrate a fear of the Lord. This fear of the Lord was the connection between the saint and God. To say one fears the Lord is demonstrated in his attitude and choices he makes in obeying the Lord. In the Old Testament, it was covenant loyalty. Today, it is living the obedient life and the power of the Spirit. It is the fear of the Lord that kept one from becoming the rigid Pharisee type, who saw life simply as do this and God will do that, then imposing this on others. This is legalism. The fear of the Lord kept one in the Word to develop depth and insight into life. The development leads to the conclusion that life is not so simple. God works in all kinds of ways that we do not understand, but we learn to trust in His greater wisdom and not so much in our limited understanding. This helps us in becoming judgmental and condemning of others, so we can be gracious towards the sinner, offering him love and giving the gospel to fulfill his greatest need, giving him the gospel or her the gospel. We can be non-judgmental to the believer who may be doing things and making decisions we do not understand. Let me give you some illustration on this. We know the Bible teaches that every person, when he's born, he is given, not a very good block, I'm writing on the edge of my tablet, that's why, he is given inside of him the basic rules of morality. He knows right and wrong. As soon as he understands, he's old enough to understand that there's a God and there's a difference between right and wrong, he knows it's wrong to lie. He knows it's wrong to steal. It's wrong to hurt people. He learns that early in life. Part of that is because he already has it within him. His parents can help him develop it better. Now, when you become a Christian, you have another standard to live by. You have now the Word of God, which teaches you such things as love God, love your neighbor. It gives you all kinds of instructions, doesn't it? So you become smarter and a better Christian. Wisdom also comes from the Word, but let's just make it a little different here. Let's put it right over here. Wisdom tells you to live the best in this world. How to live the best in this world. All right? Now, if you lived under the old covenant, you would live this wisdom and the Word all within the Mosaic law. It told you to do your ritual at the temple, to make your sacrifices. These are things you had to live within. This was all part of obedience. So you had to live obedient to the Mosaic law. Today, we live under the new covenant. I want to shorten this. New covenant. We have the New Testament, Word. We also have wisdom. I just mentioned the Word. We also begin with morality. We also have the Spirit of God. This is a huge advantage to have the Spirit. Plus, we have all the Bible now. So we have a higher standard to live by, but we're also given the power to do it. Okay? If you lived during Old Testament times, let's say you lived over there on the other side of the Jordan. Let's say you lived in Edom, Job's old stomping ground. You want to know God? Well, first of all, you'd have to do something in your mind or even physically, move away from that system over there that believed in many gods and come over to Israel. Let's say you lived in Edom down here. You'd have to come over to Israel and begin to live under the Mosaic law and understand there's only one God and worship Him and pursue Him and listen to Israel's prophets and priests, live according to the Mosaic law. Then you would come under God's blessing. That's how you came into it. Now, we've also learned that the Israel wise person would also spread the gospel of God to those outside his nation, like Jonah. Remember, he went to Nineveh. He was reluctant to do so, but eventually did it. God sort of made him, didn't he? And he got there. I don't even think he was smelling like a fish, but he could have. Though some would say that a whale's not a fish, but let's not get too technical here. Okay, so this is the way the Old Testament saint had to live. According to the law, if he wanted the best out of life, he lived wisdom. But he still had to stay within the law, obey the word, and of course he was fundamentally moral. Today, we don't have the Mosaic law. We have the new covenant. We have a greater law, you might say. That is that we live by the Spirit. The Spirit guides us, motivates us, enables us, gifts us. Basically, it is the only way to live today under the new covenant. So, when we talk about the fear of the Lord, we're talking about someone who understands the importance of God's authority and reveres God. If you don't understand that, then you're not going to get anywhere with the word or wisdom or even the Mosaic law. If you fear the Lord, you're going to love God. You're going to love your neighbor. This is what Jesus taught. It came out in Jesus' teachings, I should say. Old Testament taught it too, but Jesus brought that out. You want to live the obedient life, then you love God and you love your neighbor. And you show that in many different ways. You don't steal from him. You don't commit adultery. You don't lie to him. You don't give a false testimony. That comes out of the Ten Commandments, doesn't it? Well, that carries right over into the New Testament as well. You don't cheat them. You're honest with them. You help them. You help your neighbor if you can, right? Those are some of the principles that come right over into the New Testament as well. Now, we don't keep the Sabbath. We do go to church, that's true. But the Sabbath was something for Israel. Okay? It was also on a Saturday, not on a Sunday. And the Sabbath today, well, the Bible teaches a different principle about the Sabbath. That's a rest. Remember, the Sabbath means rest. We rest in the Lord every day. All I'm doing is showing you that sometimes when it comes to studying a proverb or something in the Old Testament, to make sure that we interpret it properly, like the Proverbs were taught with the Mosaic law in mind. If they want to get the best out of life in the Old Testament days, they lived according to word. They did even better when they applied wisdom. And they always had to obey the Mosaic law. Which brings us to our next principle of the retribution principle. Our next theme, retribution principle, part 3. I call it part 3 because we've already had 1 and 2. The retribution principle may be called an extension, added on, of the blessing and cursing sections of the law. Now remember, the blessing and cursing sections of the law taught as a nation, Israel, if you're obedient, you get blessed as a nation. If you're disobedient, you get cursed, and you can suffer famine and pestilence and war and lose wars and even go into captivity or have your nation destroyed. That was the blessing and cursing clauses of the Mosaic law. which said, basically, if you obey, blessing, if you disobey, cursing. This basic principle was viewed as applying to individuals, and that's where we come to the retribution principle. In the Old Testament, it was through the covenant that one experienced covenant loyalty with God and could receive the blessings from God. When the believer was disobedient, he would experience cursing to some degree, and that he would miss blessing and come under discipline. The unbeliever could be blessed if moral, but only to a degree, and then ultimately fall under the cursing. Let's go back to our picture for a second. The unbeliever can be moral. Don't forget that. And morality was given to the human race. All the human race. Well, if you get married, you marry the opposite sex and you stay in marriage for life. That's the principle. You work hard. All right? That's a principle. You be productive. That's all part of morality. And you treat your fellow man decently. You don't steal, you don't lie and false witness and so on, things like that. That's for the human race. If you become a believer, you begin to obey the word. You become a smart believer, you begin to apply wisdom, you see? Now remember, the Mosaic Law was a covenant. So when you talk about covenant in the Old Testament, you're talking about the Mosaic Law. So here we go. We're going to go back to that and talk about covenant now. Only the nation Israel had a covenant relationship with the Lord God. Individuals experience that covenant loyalty through their adherence to the covenant as well. You want to be blessed in Israel? Well, you got to live according to the covenants too. You got to do your sacrifices. You got to go to the festivals. You got to obey the instructions of the king. These are all part of doing what was right in Israel. Living in that covenant relationship. Remember, the king represented God. With the individual saint, wisdom played a big role, for wisdom taught one how to live in loyalty to God, not just in obedience, but in making wise choices in a complex world full of difficult choices. The faithful live the godly lifestyle. Those outside the covenant do not. Believers could live in obedience and live godly lives, but they could choose to go astray and live ungodly. This is where wisdom comes in to help keep the believer and to help keep the believer on the right path or get one back on the right track with obedience. So if you decided to be disobedient, even bring cursing on yourself, the way to get back is start being wise. Repent, come back, and live wise again. Now let's do a little bit of review. Retribution Principle 1 teaches that there is an ideal way of life. Being obedient and following wisdom brings prosperity and a long good life. Disobedience and foolishness brings poverty and a short miserable life. This principle was expected to be fulfilled in this life. That means on this planet, on this world. Retribution 2, Principle 2, teaches that there are exceptions found in the wisdom of God. We learned this about Job. Retribution Principle 3 teaches that life is full of exceptions to the rule. Many exceptions. Even trying to see a pattern. It's difficult. There's so many exceptions. Read along in this verse. This is Ecclesiastes, some of Solomon's wisdom in his older life. I've seen something else under the sun. The race is not to the swift, or the battle to the strong, nor does food come to the wise, or wealth to the brilliant, or favor to the learned. But time and chance happen to them all. Now, is this true? Well, from the observation of Solomon, he learned just because you got the biggest, strongest military doesn't mean you're going to win every battle. just because you're wise doesn't mean you're going to have food all the time. That is smart. Or wealth to the brilliant. That's the idea. Or favor to the learned. You get a good education, that means you're going to do well in life? Not necessarily. You may get out of college with a degree or two and can't find a job. And you're back there at that old store working where you used to when you were in high school. The last line, but time and chance happened all. From his observation, you just never know how things are going to turn out. And that's the way you put it in this kind of phrase, time and chance. Today, this is especially true since we live in the final stages before the Kingdom of God Phase 2. I hope you've learned that well. Kingdom of God Phase 2 is when Christ comes back and sets up his kingdom on earth. Kingdom of God Phase 1 is what we live in right now. We have the Holy Spirit living in the New Covenant Church. And in the period of the New Covenant Church, we're in the latter stages right now, approaching Phase 2, Kingdom of God. We are in an intense conflict with Satan and his forces, who's about to set up their way on earth. And that has pretty much been going that way for a long time, by the way. He reaches his peak during the tribulation. But that's also when God starts to judge planet Earth and everybody on Earth. The church is not based nationally. Well, let me finish this. Let me do this first sentence again. Today, this is especially true since we live in the final stages before the Kingdom of God Phase 2. We live now in Kingdom of God Phase 1 with the Spirit under the New Covenant in the church. The church is not based nationally, but internationally through the universal church. So we don't have a Christian nation today. We don't have a church nation, however you want to put it. We are universally based. The church is all around the world. All right, that's what this is saying. It's not to say that some nations can't have Christian principles. Some people may call them Christian nations, but not in the sense of Israel. All right? Not in the sense of Israel. It's different. Retribution Principle 3. Here we go. Leads us to conclude that life is full of complexities that we cannot explain and only hazard a guess. That means take a guess on many things. Guessing at why things are happening the way they are or to that person or to us may be helpful, but can be misleading. How many times has the well-intentioned Christian thought and said, God is doing this for me, when in fact he really doesn't know at all? We should be warned about guessing at these things. How many times have you guessed at them and been wrong? Listen and read this carefully, or read it. The Proverbs are general principles that are usually true based on experience and observation and learning that this is the way it usually is. It is often gained with experience and age. They are not promises because they don't always hold true. The righteous do not always experience prosperity and a good life in this world. He may be a righteous sufferer much of his or her life. One must distinguish between what is a promise that comes in the form of a truth and a general statement that is often true but not always. We have seen that the individual's life is not so simple as applying the blessing and cursing principles of the nation upon the individual. There are too many exceptions. So understand this. Let me read this again. We have seen that the individual's life is not so simple as applying the blessing and cursing principles of the nation upon the individual. There are too many exceptions. So that's where we see Retribution Principle 2. One can ponder all day long on why the wicked do so well in so many areas of life. Good health, prosperity, power, while the righteous are coming up well short on all these things. Listen to this part of the psalm, Psalm 73, 16 through 17. It gives a deeper answer. 16. When I tried to understand all this, it troubled me deeply, till I entered the sanctuary of God. Then I understood there, that's the wicked's, final destiny. You see, you really are puzzled over why the wicked are doing so well on this earth until you realize where they're going to end up. You see, this is all they're going to get. This is all the wealth and comfort and fame and power they're going to get is during this short years on earth. And some of them are quite short. Now and then I watch an old movie and I said, well, I haven't seen that movie starring many, many years. I look it up. They died at 39, car wreck or something, or 59 of cancer. Something like that. Are they still alive, but you never hear of them. They don't even want to be shown up in public. They don't look like they used to. What I'm saying is, this is not to say that all movie stars are wicked, of course not, but wicked people will get what they deserve in the end, no matter what you see now. Now listen how this psalm goes on. This is interesting. So after you say here, he says here, I understood their final destiny. The psalm goes on to describe what ultimately happens to the wicked. He's cast down to ruin, destroyed, completely swept away by terrors. Then the psalmist continues and describes his own ignorance like a brute beast. He's saying, like, I'm as dumb as an animal when it comes to knowing these things. He realizes how little he knows. But God is continually with him, holding his hand, guiding him with wise advice to the place of honor. Note the important place of wisdom, wise advice. It gives the right perspective of life. You begin to understand why the wicked prosper. Finally, one of the great benefits that result from understanding the importance of wisdom and applying it to the character development of the saint, far more valuable than the well-being of riches, wealth, good health, power, and promotion, is the development of the righteous life, wise discretion, justice and integrity that comes from living out wisdom in one's life. Let's talk about wisdom in human speech. Proverbs has a lot to say about the use of the tongue. Three of the seven abominations are related to the tongue. Three primary teachings about the tongue can be summed up. First, there is great power with words to give death or life, wound or heal. The wicked can spread strife like fire with his words. The righteous can be like a fountain or tree of life when he dispenses, that means to give out knowledge. And the wicked conceals violence, gushes folly, and crushes the spirit with words. Second, words can be empty and useless. Words are not a substitute for action. Words cannot change the facts and are used to cover evil motives, but are ultimately exposed. Third, the Proverbs teach how to speak well. They come from a righteous character. Those who speak with righteousness are valued by rulers and the people. Keeping one's speech brief helps prevent facts from being distorted. Gentle speech prevents anger. And there is joy from giving the apt answer, that is, the right answer. Let's talk about homosexuality. The wisdom of Proverbs extols the virtue of a monogamous marriage. If you don't know what that means you're married to one person. Heterosexual, that means man and a woman, all right? None of this homosexual stuff that's so popular today. That's all an abomination. Very sinful. So the wisdom of Proverbs extols the virtue of a monogamous heterosexual marriage and warns against sexual promiscuity. Promiscuity is another word for abusing, misusing, playing around with sex, not using it properly within marriage. And these principles are just as applicable today. Wisdom teaches the importance of choosing a marriage partner who has a strong character who has strong character traits over mere external beauty. That's not saying you can't marry someone you think's attractive, of course. But always looking for the most beautiful woman is not near as important as looking for one who you're attracted to, who has a strong Christian character. Same way with a woman looking for a man. She wants a man with a strong Christian character. Wisdom instruction on the sanctity of marriage, that means how precious it is set apart to one person, and the pleasure of appropriate heterosexual love within marriage. In other words, having sex with your partner, that's the boundaries. Your partner being your marriage partner, always. Wisdom teaches of the subtle dangers of sexual sins. Wisdom teaches that men can easily be enticed, that means kind of be led astray or trapped, to commit sexual sins. Wisdom keeps the man from the adulterous woman. Wisdom teaches to guard your mouth and ears from the adulterous. You got to watch how you talk to women, young men, older men. And women, you need to make sure you talk right and respectful to men. Don't lead them on. Don't tempt them. Wisdom teaches that a nagging or quarrelsome wife makes life miserable. By the way, that means that her life is already miserable. 19:13, 27:15. Just thought I'd throw those scriptures in. These principles are grounded in the teaching of Scripture that from the beginning, the design of marriage has been one man for one woman for life. Let's pray. Father, we again thank you for your word. It's been very challenging today. Help us realize not only the importance of wisdom, but if we want to make the best choices, that we will also grow in wisdom. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.